Okay, so we are recording, and again, we'll get lots of nice little traffic noises. So welcome to worship. It's good to be here in our first worship service that is on Zoom and in person. And we begin worship with a prayer of confession and forgiveness. The blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation.
Amen.
Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We join in singing, "You Have Come Down to the Lake Shore."
Of the swimming
Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for your Son who chose the path of suffering for the sake of the world. Humble us by his example. Point us to the path of obedience and give us strength to follow your commands through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. This is where, for the past few weeks, we've had a Dear Church segment where people who were participating in Dear Church, the book study, were sharing how they reflections on that book. And today, everybody in the book study has shared a reflection. And so I had it in the bulletin with no name. And it's actually something I would like to keep, because I would like us to keep reflecting on our own journeys and learning about racism. And so I would invite any of you who want to share something you're learning or have any questions to contact me so that we can get you in our rotation. But for today, I want to invite you all again to participate in the study that we're doing right now, which is How to Be an Anti-Racist. And if you want to join in that study and start reading the book, we're only on chapter 3, or we just finished chapter 3. And so there's chapters are very, very short, so you can catch up. And if you want to join in the discussion on Tuesday night at 7, please feel free to do so. And now we will go to our first lesson. From Romans chapter 12, verses 9 to 21, Paul writes, "Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine. I will repay," says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah. The Lord will be seen. To whom shall we go? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Your word is life.
I am so not used to standing up for the gospel anymore. I come out and I look at you all and I was like, wow, that's something we do, isn't it? The Holy Gospel according to Matthew in the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
From that time on, after Peter confessed that Jesus was the Messiah, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you." But Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. For you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming into his kingdom." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us pray. Gracious God, as we are gathered here, as we are gathered through the technology of the internet, we pray as we reflect upon your word. Help us to know your presence. Help us to recognize your call. In Jesus' name, amen. So last week we talked about Jesus calling Peter the rock, right? And I talked about how Peter's faith was so strong at that time that, you know, he actually went from Simon to Peter, a name change, meaning the rock on which the church would be built. And it didn't take long for him to stumble, did it? In the gospel, it says, Jesus says, you are a stumbling block. It could also be interpreted as you are a stumbling stone. I would say you are a rock that causes people to trip, because that's what he was called the week before. I mean, a few days before, but the week before for us, for our purposes. Notice, though, that Peter, in his trying to be respective of Jesus, he didn't just like blurt out. I always imagine it, until I reread the text, I imagine that Peter heard Jesus say that and said, no, that can't be. But you see, Peter actually pulled Jesus aside. Like, you know, Jesus, come over here. Let me correct you, because you seem to have this wrong. Remember, what was Peter expecting? He was expecting the Messiah, the person who is going to restore Israel, who's going to kick out all the oppressors, put them back in power. That's what Peter was expecting. So for Jesus to say, I'm going to have to go to Jerusalem and I'm going to undergo great suffering at the hands of the establishment, the religious establishment, in conjunction with the legal establishment, I'm going to die and I'm going to be raised. And Peter's like, no, I don't get that. And Peter and Jesus responds to Peter, get behind me, Satan. It's kind of an allusion to the temptations at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, when Satan was trying to tempt Jesus into being the kind of leader that Peter is actually expecting. You are a stumbling block. You are a stumbling stone. You make me trip. And what causes? Jesus tells us exactly what causes that stumbling. It's setting your mind on human things instead of divine things. Now, most of you know that I'm really, really good at tripping, because you see me coming in to worship once in a while with bloody knees and things like that. And it was almost exactly a year ago when Scott got his diagnosis. We knew that there was something wrong and trying to figure out what it was. And it was on a Tuesday that we got the final word of what that diagnosis was. And in that last summer, I was coordinating Tuesday trails. And so every Tuesday we would go and we'd meet at a various trail for an hour run. And so I'm like, I'm just going to continue, because we were trying, you know, continue our lives as we live them. And so I went to the Ray Miller Trail there was like six or seven of us. Back, you know, when we could do those things. And I've been up and down that trail hundreds of times now. But it's a very rocky trail. Some areas nice and smooth, and others very rocky. And as I'm running, my mind was on Scott and his illness. And so about 20 minutes into the run going up, I tripped, and I had tripped the week before, but I tripped and I had like cut open my hand. And so there was nice blood coming down my hand. I scraped my knee, had like blood running down my leg. And I was just mad, because I know that particular rocky area, I need to be paying attention to what I'm doing. So I pick myself up and I keep going until my turnaround. I turn around and I come down and I'm running down. And then I get to one of the easy areas. An easy area is an area where the trail looks pretty smooth. And I'm like, okay, I'm almost done. I have a half a mile to go. Cause I kind of, you run a trail long enough, actually, you know exactly where you are mileage wise. And boom, there I go. Down again. So two times in one run. And I think in retrospect, I'm like, you know, maybe today wasn't the best day to go for a run, because my mind was not on what it needed to be on to be safe out there. And I think that a lot of times we stumble because our minds are not where they need to be. So Jesus is telling Peter, you're a stumbling block because you're setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. And how often do we stumble? Because we have our minds set on human things and not divine things. When we have our minds set on what's comfortable for us instead of what is good for our neighbor. When we have our minds set on, I just want things to stay the way they are for me, instead of giving up something in love of neighbor, in support of neighbor. 3 years ago, I preached a sermon titled Stumbling Stones. It was not on this text. It was on a Romans text where Paul wrote, what are we then to say? Gentiles who did not strive for righteousness have attained it. That is righteousness through faith. But Israel, who did strive for the righteousness that is based on the law, did not succeed in fulfilling the law. Why not? Because they did not strive for it on the basis of faith, but as if it was based on works. They have stumbled over the stumbling stone. We stumble over stumbling stones. And it was interesting when I went and looked back at this sermon, because in my mind I'm like, stumbling stone, I know I talked about stumbling stones. And I just want to share with you some of what I had said, because it's just, it's amazing to me how things haven't changed.
Hello, Sue.
It happened to be the week after, the Sunday after, the march of white supremacists in Charlottesville. So was that 3 years ago? I don't remember, I think. And I'm going to just share some of that sermon. I wrote, I was prepared to talk about the crisis that we have in our country of social isolation, of the need for community. Boy, that's still a crisis, isn't it? That's a crisis that is like been amplified big time, because so many people, all of us are supposed to be in our homes, and so many people who don't have family living with them are incredibly lonely. I wrote, I had a whole lot to say about these things, about how we as the church could be part of the solution to social isolation, but then Charlottesville happened. And I think about our stumbling stone that we have as a church, and for the ELCA, a largely white church, and as a nation. And that stumbling stone is racism. It seems easy to look back in history and think, it was obvious then, they could see it. It's like being on the path and seeing the obvious stone to trip over. And I'm talking about past racial unjustness. But in reality, if I was living in those times, like in the 60s, 50s, during Jim Crow, maybe it wouldn't have been so obvious to me. But today, we Christians have a choice. Are we going to close our eyes to racism, or are we going to stand up and say, no, it's not okay. It's never okay. But a challenge with the stumbling stone of racism is that there are so many hidden stones that we have tripped over so many times that our legs and our bodies are all bloodied and we don't recognize it. We just know it hurts and we don't know why. We know something is wrong. We trip over the stone of our fear of other people. We trip over the stone that leads us to believe the negative stereotypes of other people rather than getting to know them. We draw conclusions on groups because of the actions of a few. How many times have we expected, now this is kind of a mixture of 3 years ago and now, because I can't ever follow a manuscript anyway. But how many times have we ever expected one person to speak for their group, their ethnic group? How many times have our African American, our Black brothers and sisters had to speak for their group? Or to respond to the demands made by white people for an explanation of whatever? The systemic racism that has benefited white people throughout the history of our nation is a stone that is hidden. It's so hidden that it causes many of us to become defensive and angry when it's brought to our attention. It's a stumbling stone when we see people killed because they're driving while Black. 3 years ago. Or a man holding a toy gun at Walmart. Do you remember that one? Or a 12-year-old boy, Tamir Rice, holding a gun. Not a gun. A toy gun in a public park. Fast forward to this week. A 17-year-old white boy can walk the streets with an assault rifle with impunity. But 12-year-old Tamir Rice was playing with a toy gun in a park across the street from his home, and the police pulled up and shot him and killed him. In Charlottesville, they were able to march, many of them carrying guns, with no repercussions. There was no police presence shooting tear gas at them. No police presence pushing them away. That's called privilege and racism. I've been a pastor for 7 years, now it's 10. The two things I was so naive about when I studied to be a pastor was how often we would have to address two topics, racism and mass shootings, massacres via guns. And you know those two things are actually related. I would love to say that today we would say, okay, we're done with this, we've moved on, but we haven't. And I believe, as many as y'all have heard me say over the years, that God calls us to be about a solution, not the continuation of the problem. The song that we sang to open the worship service is a song of call. You have called me by name. I had that song at my ordination service. But you know, that call is for all of us to be about the solution. For us, that might mean right now learning the real history of racism in these United States. It's about learning about policies that lead to inequity and being about changing policies. We could do that. We can be part of that. Three years ago, I reread a sermon that I wrote after Ferguson, where in that sermon, I said, God loves Michael Brown. Michael Brown was the young man murdered in Ferguson. God loves Tamir Rice, who I just mentioned, the 12-year-old boy killed while playing with a toy gun. And then I said, God loves Darren Wilson. Do you guys know who Darren Wilson is? He's the one who killed Michael Brown. And then and now, I am so tempted to not have that sentence. Which then reminds me of another sermon when another event, when we put 50 crosses on the lawn after the Pulse massacre. And we only actually put 49 crosses. And then Mike Blankenship said, well, what about the 50th cross for the person who killed everyone? And I said, I can't put that cross up today. And then we talked about it on Sunday. And Candace, do you guys, if you remember Candace, she after worship went out and put up that 50th cross. That's important for us to remember. Because if God's grace is not for everyone, it's for no one. And if God's grace doesn't offend us, then it isn't for us either. We continue to not live in an easy time. We continue to be called to look at our own racism. I like it when somebody says, hey, Pastor Nancy, what you said, it's racist. Because we all will say and do things that we don't recognize. And so we need help in calling it out to one another in a loving way. I think I shared with you before when I was talking about it in our dear church, and Robin's friend in the background said, hey, did you hear what she just said? And she's totally oblivious to it. And that's what happens. We need to be paying attention. Jesus says here, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. That is really what we're being called to do, to pick up that cross and carry it. What does that mean? I think that the creators of our lectionary did a really good job of marrying this text with that Roman text, because when we say, what does it mean to pick up your cross and follow Jesus? It doesn't, well, first, it doesn't mean, well, look, there's a whole bunch of crosses over there, and I'm going to say, I want the little one, the one that's easier to carry. We don't get to choose our crosses. But I think the cross that all of us have right now, as Christians, as followers of God, of Jesus, that cross that we have, is about love of neighbor. So in this text from Romans, Paul's kind of telling us what to do, right? Let love be genuine, hate what is evil. racism is evil. We can hate it. Doesn't mean we hate the person, because that would mean we would have to hate ourselves. Because all of us are affected by racism. Dr. Ibram Kendi, in the book that we're all reading together, says that being racist and anti-racist is like a name tag that you put on and off, because we can be oblivious and always be racist because we're part of a racist system, but we can also be striving to be anti-racist, but that doesn't mean that we're always perfect. And that's why it becomes like a tag that comes on and off, and hopefully the anti-racist one stays on longer. We can hate what is evil by just making it not okay. It's not respectable. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. How can we learn and show honor to people who have not always received that honor? Something we can think about. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering. Yeah, it's not easy, is it? And persevere in prayer. I think that that's an important part for all of us. And then I'm going to jump. So there's just, I invite you to always reread this, because it's just such a good list of things to do. He says, do not repay anyone evil for evil. We can tell people, hey, that's not okay, without stooping. And we can make mistakes in that regard too, like I do often. And so he goes on and on. And then he says, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. Which is Jesus again telling us to love our neighbor as ourself and our neighbor, our enemy. But then he goes to say something that you might think, well, that's kind of confusing. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Does that make sense to you all? To love your neighbor, to love your enemy, to give them something to drink, to feed them. It's lumping burning coals on their heads. You're like, oh, that's a new way of fighting, isn't it? And what he's alluding to is you will change your sharing God's love and being about God's love will someday lead to repentance. Because how did people show repentance and mourning in the scriptures that Paul and Jesus had? Was by heaping coals on their head as an indication of mourning. And so that's a little illusion that we're like, I don't get. But it's a good way to think about how we actually cannot change anyone's. We don't have that power to change. You all know that in your families, right? We all have family members that we want to act differently. Can you make them do that? You can't, huh? The only thing you have power over is you, your behavior. Sometimes that behavior actually causes other people to see. So what do we want other people to see when they see us? Especially people that we might perceive as our enemies. If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to eat. I mean, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil. There's always room for hope. It doesn't have to overcome us. But we, all of us here, together, we can overcome evil with good. That's our call. And I think we're all up to it. We don't do it alone because we have one another and we're powered by grace that is free for each of us. We can overcome evil with good. Amen. And I invite you to join in singing another song from my ordination service. Will you come and follow me? Okay, as we prepare for prayers today, we do have prayers listed in our grace notes. Jackie, I'm glad that your procedure on Friday went well. And if anyone has any prayers that they would like to share, yes.
Hi, Nancy, this is Brenda. Oh,
so here's a challenge. Hold on. Can you turn the sound back on? Yeah. Hold on. Scott's got to turn the sound back on. Okay, try again, Brenda.
Good morning. An 18-year-old daughter, a friend of ours, yesterday morning was in a horrible accident, car accident. She's a new driver, and I'm pretty sure that the car was totaled. She went to the hospital, but was released. She's doing okay at home, but very shook up. Her name is Grace. So if you can keep Grace in your prayers, recovering from an auto accident.
Okay. An auto accident. Okay, any others?
Nancy.
Yes.
Hi, if you could do a prayer request for Ma, Dolores.
Yeah.
To help her feel better, have more energy, and for us to find out what's wrong with her stomach. Mm-hmm. And just basically to make her feel better.
Okay. All right. I know that's frustrating, huh?
Yes. For her, it's very frustrating, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Other prayer concerns? Yes, Julie.
My cousin Kay is in the hospital.
Bruce?
Yes, my youngest sister passed in the hospital.
Oh, I'm sorry, yes. I got to learn to read those things back. So Julie's cousin Kay is in the hospital with in a lot of pain. So add her to your prayers. And Bruce's aunt Pat, who is on our list, I believe, is now with hospice care.
Sorry.
Betty?
Okay, when you wash those or something.
I'm sorry. So your niece... Okay. What's that? Michael?
Yes, yeah, so for Francie, who's my biological mother, she has a number of pretty serious medical issues that she deals with all the time, but she had been in the hospital last week. She's back out. But still ongoing care and then there's certainly concern for what her conditions are. So for Francie.
Okay. All right. Any others? Okay. Oh, sorry. Robert McPherson or Pearson? McPherson. Okay. So a friend of Julie's family, Robert McPherson, is starting chemotherapy. What? I'm sorry. I'm having a terrible time with all these cars.
His last round
of chemotherapy. Okay. Okay. I have to learn to look both places. Okay, let us pray. Gracious God, as we gather together in prayer, help us to always know that you love us and that you are with us. And as we gather as your church, help us to always be confident that we are helped by the Holy Spirit in our work and in our prayer, in our living, in our being. And together we pray for the church, for the world, and for all who are in need. God of faithfulness, you bid your people to follow Jesus. Set the mind of your church on divine things. Grant us to trust in you, that we lose our lives for the sake of Christ and thereby discover joy in life through him. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of wonder, the earth is yours and all that is in it. Heal your creation and give us eyes to see the world as you do. As the seasons change, pattern the rhythm of our lives in harmony with all creation. Lord, in your mercy, God of all nations, you call us to live peaceably with all. Give us ears to hear one another, even those we name as enemies. Help us to recognize that you are indeed the God of all nations, that all people of the world are our siblings, created in your image. We pray that you would continue to fill leaders with mercy, with understanding, with good judgment, and that you would lead them to advocate for and genuinely care for those who are poor and most vulnerable in their communities. And we pray that you would lead us to advocate and care, that we would be about policy that is anti-racist, policy that is equitable for all. Lord, in your mercy, God of salvation, you promise to deliver us. Give those who suffer a strong sense of your presence and of your love. Accompany those who are uncertain. Raise the spirits of those who are despairing and heal the sick, especially those whose names are listed in our grace notes and all those who we've mentioned before you. Help them all to know your care, to feel your strength. Keep us praying and caring for one another. Lord, in your mercy, God of community, you call us to rejoice in hope, to be patient in suffering, and to persevere in prayer. Make our congregation a workshop in your love. Help us to be known in this community as a place where everyone is valued, as a place that works for equity, as a place that exhibits your grace. Help us to overcome evil with good. Lord, in your mercy, God of all grace, you give us everlasting life. In love, we recall your holy ones who live now in your undying light. And today we are especially grateful for the life of Errol David Ferguson. In our remembering, give each of us a foretaste of the feast to come. Lord, in your mercy, and in the certain hope that there's absolutely nothing in all creation that can ever separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ. Amen. And may the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
You can share that piece by waving. Even you all, you don't get to.
I can see you through here.
Oh, yeah, you. So I guess next time we do this, we'll have to have you guys all over on this side, huh? Or we had a sunshade that we were going to put up, but it's gone. Yeah. So if anyone knows what happened to the sunshade that was upstairs, no, but we'll ask preschool if they did something with it. So, I don't know, I got shade. No, so it's as we are not gathering the offering, those who are present, I should have put an offering tray out, but I didn't. So we'll just continue to say, could drop our offerings off here at the church or online. And so, no, that's okay. You could just put the offering, and when we're done. Okay, thank you. Scott, can you hand me my bulletin that just blew away? It's under your feet. But thank you everybody for your continued generosity and support of all that we do. And we will do our offering prayer. You want me to do it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'll do it as we're working on our logistics for the sound. Let us pray. God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us through these gifts that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, gathered with his disciples. As they were gathered, he took bread, he gave thanks for it, and gave it to all to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks for it, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "In this cup is the new covenant, and my blood, which has been poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And gathered together as Jesus' disciples, let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And we will sing Lamb of God as we prepare to receive communion, wherever we happen to be located. I invite everybody to receive communion. Did you all bring communion? Julie put out some cups, so if anybody would like, I have some extra bread. If anybody would like bread or some, or Jade has crackers. And Julie has some juice. This is the body of Christ given for you. Amen. Take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
Take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. Does anybody need any wine or bread? We're good. I know it's very different, isn't it? It's not, doesn't feel as odd if, since we've been doing this at home for so long. Yes. Otherwise you would be like, whoa. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Let us pray. God of the welcome table, in this meal we have feasted on your goodness and have been united by your presence among us. Empower us to go forth sustained by these gifts so that we may share your neighborly love with all through Jesus Christ, the giver of abundant life. Amen. And receive the blessing. Neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen. And we have a new song for today, All That I Am, that brought to us by Megan and Scott. Thank you.
It's only in surrender that I'm free. It's only in surrender that I'm free. I am free. I am free. I am free. I am free. That I am.
Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.
All right. Thank you, everybody. So now we have to evaluate. And I think our biggest thing is our sound is what we have to get on. So, but any comments you have or nice to be here. So, and how about everyone on Zoom? How was it like? Pretty much the same, big different, or I don't know. What's your opinion? Oh, wait, let me.
I thought it was pretty much the same. The last song was hard to hear.
The last song was hard to hear? Okay. Huh. Yeah, we're going to have to figure out the sound part. I think that... now that we did it, and yesterday and today, now we know better what we need to work on.
Yeah.
But thank you for that feedback.
Yeah, the other songs were okay. It was just the last one.
That's weird because he does them all the same.
Yeah, Nancy.
Yes.
We couldn't hear any of the songs.
Oh, okay. They couldn't hear any of the songs.
At the very beginning, I think it was the first song we heard, but then after that, we didn't hear any of them.
Okay. Nancy, it was tough for us too. Very, very faint on the songs. Could hardly hear the music at all. And then some of them, it was almost, I told Brenda, it's like listening to AM radio when we were kids and you would walk and it would go in and out and in and out, but you could never really hear it very good anyway. Okay. It's too bad. They were great songs too. I would really wish we could have heard them, but so that's the thing we need to work on is making the sound come through.
All right. He's going to try and play that song again because he just adjusted the volume on it. So you guys let me know with a thumbs up or thumbs down whether you can hear it once it starts. Okay?
Yeah, I want to hear it. Megan has such a beautiful voice.
Yes.
You hear it?
No.
They can't hear it. All right, so that's our... Oh, he's going to try one more thing. Yeah, it's better for us. Oh, shoot, stop recording.